Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Can I get a mic? Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, may I invite us to take our seats. We will be starting our session in a short moment. If I could ask us kindly to settle down, we will be starting our sessions. Good afternoon to those of you who've joined us this afternoon. A warm welcome. We are well on our way into our agenda. This afternoon, we begin with Plenary 2. And in this session, the theme is strategic and organizational approaches to knowledge sharing. What have we learned so far? And to grace our panel this afternoon, if you'll allow me to invite up our panelists. Up first, let's welcome up Dr. Emmanuel Fabiano, who is the Minister of Education, Science and Technology in Malawi. Please let's welcome him up to the podium. Also on our panel is Dr. Christoph Lander, who is the Deputy Minister for Health for Poland. Please let's welcome him up. We're honored to have with us Dr. Vanessa Rubio, who is the Vice Minister of Planning, International Affairs and Evaluation, Ministry of Social Development in Mexico. Please let's join in welcoming up. And to moderate this session for us is Gwen Hines, who is Director, International Relations, Department for International Development, DFID, in the UK. A warm welcome, Gwen.
Thank you very much, and welcome back, everybody. It's good to see people have come back after lunch. I'm delighted to be back here at the World Bank. I spent 3 years here until last summer serving on the board of the World Bank as a UK representative, and I always feared I may never be allowed back, but I am delighted to be back. I should say that as well as being DFID's international director, the reason I'm here is because I lead an initiative in the UK government, in the development department, trying to do organizational learning. So I'm very much somebody who's here to learn from others about what works, what doesn't, and why. So I'm delighted to have such a distinguished panel. To prove that we're walking the talk, I'm not going to give a long introduction. You know we have a very distinguished panel. You have people's biographies. We're going to head straight into discussion and try and get some really thought-provoking questions, answers going today. So let me swap chairs, and let me start by asking His Excellency, the Honourable Minister from Education, to kick us off with a few words about how they're doing this work in Malawi. We will then go into Christoph Lander from Poland, and then Vanessa Rubio to talk about the way it's working in Mexico. So rather than breaking up, feedback earlier on was let's get it really moving, it's an interactive discussion. We're a learning conference, so let's do it that way. So please, Honourable Minister, if you wouldn't mind kicking off our discussion this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much, moderator. And good afternoon to Your Excellencies, distinguished guests that are here. I'm Emmanuel Fabiano. My background is academic. I was in the University of Malawi up to end of 2013, and I joined government as Minister of Education, Science and Technology from June 2014. So I've done less than 2 years. And what I would like to share with you is what we are doing in Malawi. And because I come from the world of the academia and the positions that I held in the University of Malawi, I was privileged to participate in a number of initiatives that the Minister of Education, Science and Technology was implementing even before I joined the ministry. In terms of organizational knowledge sharing, I'd like to inform you that the Minister of Education, Science and Technology, with the assistance of a number of development partners, worked very hard to make sure that as we plan and implement activities under the Minister of Education, Science and Technology, that is primary education, secondary education, teacher training as well as the higher education, we do that at the same time. Now, this point is worth emphasizing because in the past, in terms of planning, they were looking at each sector at a time. We didn't have a holistic perspective and planning. And this exercise led to the establishment more than 10 years ago, more than 8 years ago, of what we call the National Education Sector Plan, which covered all the sectors of education. And this exercise involved all sectors of education, the development partners, civil society organizations, the Teachers Union of Malawi, and many other individuals that were interested in education at that time. So it was as participatory as it could be. And because of that, it also took at least 2 years before the final document was produced. When that document was produced, the ministry, again, with the support of all the stakeholders, produced the National Education Implementation Plan. The National Education Sector Plan, the original document, the first document, was for a 10-year period up to 2018. So right now, we've got about 2 years to go for that plan. The National Education Implementation Plan was taking 3 years at a time. But in the process of implementation, they also carried out a mid-term review exercise, which helped to improve the activities that are currently being implemented. With this in place, the ministry produced annual work plans for each year. And for us to be able to interact with everybody, a number of initiatives were put in place. The planning division, with everybody in the ministry from primary through secondary, teacher education, as well as higher education, produce reports which they submit to the ministry. And these reports annually contribute to what we call the basic statistics in education, and this document is public. But the planning division also does a monitoring and evaluation of what is going on. And they also produce a document which is available, which gives people the knowledge and information of what is actually on the ground, what is working and what is working very well and what is not working. In other words, we are trying as much as possible to give out information to everybody. Beyond this, the departments and the departments within the ministry have got technical working groups because they have to follow up what is happening, and they feed it into what we call sector working group. So the primary school is a sector, the secondary school is a sector, teacher training is a sector, higher education is a sector, standards is a sector, decentralization is a sector. So they feed into this. But what is the beauty about this is that all the sectors that we have, 10 of them, have all the stakeholders, their representatives, as members. So when you talk about the primary school sector, when they meet and discuss what is going on, all the stakeholders in the country are invited to those meetings. And after the sectors have met, normally every quarter, we have an annual joint sector review where we present what we have achieved during the past 1 year and what we have planned to achieve in the following year. And both the reports of what we have done and the plans that we have for the following year are actually discussed thoroughly by all the stakeholders in the country, so that by the time we say we have finished the meeting, we all know what we'll be doing. But we have gone beyond that. We even sign a memorandum of understanding of what it is that we are going to achieve. So that's how transparent and participatory we have been. Let me add and say that as a country, because of the way we are managing knowledge and the way we are practicing our activities, we can say we have been very transparent, we have been very inclusive, and everybody that is involved has the ability and the right to make contributions. And therefore, as a result, what is happening now, you have the private sector, you have NGOs, civil society organizations, our development partners that come in and say that in addition to everything else that we're doing to support education, we'd like to provide the following services, including infrastructure, teaching and learning materials, something that we could not have done if the people did not know what the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology were doing. As part of the knowledge sharing, Malawi has benefited a lot from initiatives that have been implemented elsewhere. We all know that what has worked in one country does not necessarily work in the same way in a different country. And what we have done is that for all the initiatives that we borrow and learn from elsewhere, we try them out first. And when they work, that's when we implement to scale. Examples include what we call the Primary School Improvement Program, whereby schools are given resources as part of decentralization to implement their activities. And this has worked very well. We started with a pilot and we scaled up. At this point, we are moving one step forward to say that schools that do better and much better than others should be rewarded by being given a lot more money. And we believe this is an incentive that will make the teachers and the committees and the students work harder to produce more and better results. We have also what we call L-grade reading activity. We noticed over the years that our students did not have the same level of reading ability as we would have wished after Sunday 1, Sunday 2, Sunday 3, and Sunday 4. And therefore, we have implemented this on a pilot phase with different stakeholders providing the resources, and we had different pilot studies supported by different people, being implemented by different groups of people. This has worked very well, and we are now at a stage of moving to scale. We are currently printing the books so that all primary schools implement this program. It's not just a question of trying it out. It's not just a question of implementing, but we also had to train the teachers. So the teachers have been trained, and more teachers shall be trained so that with the resources and the training, we can improve the reading ability of our students. And this is in two languages, the local language as well as the English. We do implement curriculum reviews on a regular basis. Again, this is a participatory process within the country, but we also benefit from other countries within the region because we know that curricula has to be reviewed every 4 or 8 years, depending on the cycle, and we do this quite often. The fourth one I would like to share with the members, with you people, is that we have improved the way we assess the performance of the schools. So we have inspectors, we have new guidelines, and we have quality assurance standards for that exercise. We have benefited from other countries, but we are now implementing a new system that we believe will produce better results. And the next one is that as a country, we have established national education standards, and we implemented this last year. And it's something that we are proud of because it actually makes everybody understand what they are responsible for, the teachers, the students, the management, and the community, so that even without the inspectors going to the schools, the people can deliver. In summary, we have learned a lot from within the country. We have learned a lot from outside the country. We are able to implement a number of initiatives within a relatively short time because everybody is participating. And I think this is something that you would like to encourage and improve on as we move forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister Fabiano. Let me pass on to Vice Minister to talk about Poland's experience. I also noticed you were once a World Bank team leader, so I'd be interested in your experiences from that perspective as well. Thank you.
Dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I'll try to be quick and concise. Let me begin that Poland is a good example of, I guess, successful knowledge sharing experience and also resulting from the World Bank projects. So I remember as just after postgraduate school of public health, I was working for Harvard Jagiellonian Consortium for Health. That was the World Bank project. Then I remember we had a project, another World Bank project on our basic benefit package in year 2000. And actually, I was participating there and even wrote a book of one of the seven parts of deliverables on basic benefit package with Professor David Banta. Then I was also very lucky to be a team leader of the World Bank project in Serbia for HTA, so Health Technology Assessment Implementation there. So you may say that I'm a living example of successful World Bank policy implementation. Nevertheless, coming directly to knowledge sharing in healthcare, I believe that healthcare is very unique and specific with that respect. Why? Because you must have heard that such names like evidence-based policymaking, evidence-based healthcare, evidence-based decision-making. These are all concepts actually associated with knowledge-based healthcare. Today, if somebody doesn't use Cochrane database, Cochrane Library, Medline, Embase, HTA databases, clinical trials registers, and many other, this person is simply not performing well. So it is impossible not to use knowledge collected in various places. So in my opinion, the most important difficulties in knowledge sharing in healthcare, these are actually selection of the valid information. So searching for information which is needed in the right place to answer right questions. But the second issue I would like to point out is actually motivation of people. You may think that all doctors are motivated in knowledge gaining. Not necessarily. But with respect to healthcare system, getting knowledge is even more difficult because there are political issues and political confounders around it. So I believe that the major role is actually belongs to the leader or to the leaders. So if you please, I believe that there are three major factors of success of any enterprise. These three factors of success, these are people, the second people, and the third people. So you should select proper people. These people need some skills. They need knowledge. But more than that, they need to know how to pose proper questions, where to find information, how to select that information, how to analyze and synthesize this information. But also these people, if they are in the chain of knowledge passage, they not only need to know how to gain knowledge, they also need to know and have skills how to pass knowledge to the others. Therefore, building proper structures and proper human resources policy is a must. So this is it for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister Lander. So, Vice Minister Rubio, in terms of Mexico's perspective, and I also notice you're a professor at Monterrey University, so you have both a government role and also an academic role. I'm very interested to hear your experiences. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to the World Bank for the invitation. And yes, well, my experience has been basically in international finance. I used to be head of the international division of the finance ministry for a while, and that's why I am very linked to international financial organizations. And I was formerly vice minister of foreign affairs of my country, and now 6 months ago, I was appointed Vice Minister for Social Development. So now, in terms of what we do at the Ministry of Social Development, in terms of knowledge sharing, what I think is very important is that social policy needs to be evaluated constantly, as many of the other policies that we implement in our countries, as health or as any other policy. But the policies that we need to evaluate, we first need to be able to gather proper information, to be able to measure them. Whatever thing that cannot be measured cannot be improved. So we need to measure the results of our policies constantly in order for us to be able to improve their efficacy and to be able to be better in the fulfillment of our goals. So what I think has been one of the challenges in the Social Development Ministry is to gather the information, to gather up the proper information, the accurate information for decision making, for policy making, and for evaluation. And I have a relevant data that I wanted to share with you. If with me here in the panel today, I would have someone from the World Bank, I would have someone from the United Nations Development Program, and I would have someone from the OECD, and someone from the Domestic Evaluation Committee for Social Policy in Mexico, and I would ask them the same question today: how many poor there are in Mexico? The World Bank, 6 months ago, would have answered 2.3 million people. Why 6 months ago? Because the monthly earning has been changed towards the measurement for poverty. So the World Bank would have answered 6 months ago, 2.3 million people. The World Bank today answers 6.8 million people. The UNDP would answer 3.4 million people. The OECD would answer 22.1 million people, and my own measurement center in Mexico would answer 55.3 million people. So what I wanted to let you know with this example is that the way we measure is important, because a very simple, what we suppose would be a very simple question and a very simple and straightforward answer is not the case. We have this variety between 2 million and 55 million people being in poverty in Mexico. So then the question would be, my job is to attend 2 million people or 55 million people, and how to attend them and how to address the problems that these people have being poor in Mexico. So just a matter of clarifying what I just said is that basically internationally, when what you measure in terms of poverty is income. That's the basic way to measure if someone is poor or is not poor. So this is basically the difference. Where do we define the number to say one is poor and the other person is not poor? That is the main difference. But what accounts for this very large difference between the 55 million people that my domestic center in Mexico accounts for? Well, the difference is because ours is the most strict measurement for poverty in the world, which is good, I think, because it makes us work more, it makes us work more broadly in the different lack of services that people have. But in Mexico, we not only measure income, but we also measure the lack of access of Mexicans to social rights. Social rights being food, social rights being education, social rights being access to health, to social security, to housing, to services for housing. So this very broad spectrum of income plus the lack of access to all these social rights, as we call them in the Mexican Constitution, is what implies that Mexico has the amount of 55 million people being in poverty, which not necessarily means that they don't have a certain income to be able to put food in their mouths, but perhaps that they live in a remote area where there's no electricity, or that they live in a home where they don't have a firm floor or a firm ceiling, or perhaps they do not have access to basic health, or they do not have access to a pension system, which is another factor that makes people poor in the Mexico's definition. So what I wanted to point in my first intervention is this, that in order for us to be effective in the policies we make, either it's in health, in education, in social security, or in any public policy, we need to be able to measure. And when we need to measure, we need to have proper and accurate information. And when we compare ourselves, we need to compare pears with pears and apples with apples. Otherwise, it's very difficult to have standards, to have international standards, and to be able to learn from others' experiences. So what I think we're doing, and we're doing well here at the World Bank, is to set a set of standards in terms of which policies in social development have worked better than others, in terms of having a same measurement for poverty in the world, so we can compare with the same policies and same measurements in other countries. And in sharing this information, and knowing what kind of information we're sharing, it's a very important topic when we talk about the effects and the positive effects of knowledge sharing. Because if I would sit here and compare to other countries that only measure poverty with income, perhaps all what we have been discussing is not the same way, is not in the same wavelength, or is not in the same tenor, so we can be more effective and more productive in the approaches towards experience sharing internationally. So I think I'll leave my comments here, and I'm looking forward for the rest of the interventions and the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Some really interesting opening remarks covering a range of different issues, from Minister, the participatory nature of the process to make sure that communication happens at that level, and transparency being really key, and then a strong focus on evidence and measurement coming out from all of you, I think. To give the audience time, I'm going to open it up for questions, so please feel free to go to the microphone if you would like to ask some questions. But whilst you're warming up, I would like to ask from my side, one of the things that always struck me when I was sitting on the World Bank board, and this focus on the World Bank as a knowledge broker, how transferable is knowledge from one country to another? So as you're saying, in Mexico, there's really big data issues. I know that in Malawi, there's some very basic issues with resources and with struggling to get enough teachers into the classrooms, for example. So how transferable are experiences from one to the other? I mean, Minister, are there lessons which Malawi has learned from other countries? And do you think there are lessons in term that Malawi can share with other places? I'd be very interested to know, and from Poland's example as well. You know, I know that in the UK, we look to countries like Poland and the progress which has been made on a number of issues. So I'm just very interested to explore this issue that at some level we can all learn from each other. But are there limits to that? And what is the best way of sharing that information? Please, Minister.
Thank you very much. Yes, it is true that we can share knowledge, but when we share knowledge, we also have to look at the context in which that knowledge is being transferred. And the reasons are very simple. In the first place, all new ideas can be successful if there is a strong political will at leadership level, not at political level, but at leadership level. And you find out that the same good ideas will work in one country, but may not work in another country. The second one, the financial resources that are at your disposal. One country might be better endowed in terms of finances, can implement the same ideas quickly, whereas another country that is financially not as endowed will struggle to implement the same good ideas. Then you have the personnel that you have in an institution in a country. One country may have very well qualified people that can easily see, absorb, and use information, whereas another country may not have the people that can transfer that information for the betterment of their people. And therefore, this is why I said in everything that we do in Malawi, especially when we are transferring knowledge from one country to another, or it has been brought in by development partners, we always try it out. Until we are sure that it will work in our system, we don't scale it up. I think that's the bottom line, because there are so many variables that impact on the effectiveness of transfer of knowledge from one place to another.
Knowledge is definitely transferable from country to country in healthcare. Let me, maybe not all, I will give you also examples on what cannot be transferred from country to country, but a positive example would be how we learned from African country, which is called Rwanda. Actually, that was the work of Pia Schneider from the World Bank. She's Austrian. Very nice work on their basic benefit package and health insurance system. Actually, their health premium is $7.5 a year. So they have very limited basic benefit package. There are just three items there. I don't know if I remember well. This is the one visit at the GP's office per year for free, transportation to the hospital, and something else, right? And their system is balanced. So they collect enough money for what is actually granted in their basic benefit package. What would have happened to that system if they introduce computed tomography, or very expensive drugs for sclerosis multiplex, or they would introduce highly sophisticated neurosurgical procedures? Immediately, without additional resources, their system would be imbalanced. Immediately, they would create waiting lists, corruption would rise, and reuse of privilege. So if I know this doctor, I will not be waiting on the waiting list. So that this is clear knowledge, which is actually applicable to any country. If you see Eurohealth Consumer Index and comparison of European countries, you will see half of them marked green and half of them colored red. Red, it means that there are substantial waiting times there. So these systems are imbalanced. They promise to the societies much more in their basic benefit packages that they can afford, they can finance. On the other hand, you see countries in green, and these countries are well balanced. So they promise, they keep their promises to the society, and they treat society in a serious way. So they don't exaggerate. They don't put too many health technologies in comparison to the resources which are available. And there are many examples, positive examples like that. I told you that there is actually common the world database on health technologies. So clinical aspects, efficacy, safety, this knowledge is transferable, and actually this is very efficient process in medicine in general. What is the problem? The problem is cost data, which is actually local. So economic evaluations, financial evaluations, they need to be localized. And obviously, localized will be decision-making on the content of basic benefit package. So what drugs are going to be reimbursed? What services are going to stay out of basic benefit package? So the answer is yes and no. There are many, I believe, the prevailing positive examples of knowledge sharing in healthcare, while there are some country-specific issues, although we still can learn how to evaluate costs, economic issues, financial issues. So this is like a rod, not the fish. Fish will be different in different countries, but rod, we can share experience how to catch fish from country to country. Thank you.
Thank you. We're having a good day for analogies, please.
Thank you. I must say my blunt answer is yes, totally agree with transferable knowledge. It would be yes and yes. I don't see any downside on transferring knowledge. What obviously needs to be done is to transfer the most knowledge you can, and then you can see what you can use, you can see what you can adapt, you can see what you implement, but just the fact that we transfer knowledge, I think, is something we must enhance, we must produce, and we must use in a more out-of-the-box thinking. Technologies are there. I think technologies are there to maximize the transferring of knowledge, the sharing of knowledge. I think it's amazing to see the possibility now that online you can do a knee solving of a problem, or of a given problem, at the same time from different opinions and minds around the world. It doesn't matter if it's a girl 10 years old and then a PhD 45. All of the people can be connected in at the same time towards solving or giving solutions or giving options through knowledge sharing to a certain problem that can be an amazing way of new collective work internationally for trying to address a certain area or a certain problem or a certain policy outcome, no? So I'm a big fan of knowledge sharing at all times. I think it then depends on the processing of that information, on the processing of that knowledge, how you take advantage of it, how you take some pieces of it, how you take a perspective of it, how you take how you make it more domestic or more implementable in your own context. But I think knowledge sharing per se should be promoted. I totally agree that we need to make it comparable, that we need to make it systematized, and we need to make it fit into a certain context. And I think we should promote the possibility of the country, of countries around the world, to be able to have access to these new technologies of building blocks towards attaining a certain goal in a policy outcome derived from knowledge sharing from different perspectives. So I think there is still a way forward in terms of how institutions such as the World Bank can provide to countries for a better platform to these innovations in thinking, to these innovations in problem solving, to these innovations in knowledge sharing. And it depends, and it will depend always on the final policymaker at a certain country or at a certain organization on what to pick from those experiences, what to pick from those, from that information available, but always to have more information available, to have more information and experience transferred and shared. I think it's a good option per se.
Thank you. I'm really interested to come back in a minute to the practical realities of how you do this. And I was reflecting this morning with our discussion from Microsoft of it isn't just technology, but technology helps. And I have to say, I sit in the UK with a government IT system, which is not brilliant. And I wonder how we're going to do it within the UK. So I'm very interested to understand from other people, how is it working and in your country? And particularly when you don't have all this technology, but also how development partners can help. But I think we've got some questions appearing from the audience. So I'd like to encourage people to take the stand. Please, if you could go to the microphone, it would just make the logistics easier. Thank you.
Well, my name is Samih El-Saharti. I work as a senior health specialist at the World Bank. First of all, I would like to thank the panelists for their insights on knowledge sharing. My question actually is related to the policy decision-making. Most policy makers make decisions based on information that they get from experts, from academics, from advisors, and so on and so forth. And this information is usually drawn, as the Deputy Minister of Health mentioned, on evidence and published documents and so on and so forth. But also, a good part of that decision making builds also on tacit knowledge, on experience of people around the policymaker who draw from their own experience, which we call tacit knowledge, which is mainly in their heads. And this is one of the challenges that we're sharing in knowledge, that we are facing in knowledge sharing, which is, you know, how can we capture this tacit knowledge so that we can actually make it transferable, whether within the country or to other countries. So I was actually wondering if you have any experience in terms of capturing this tacit knowledge in your respective sectors and countries. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to ask for two or three questions, and then let's group them if that's okay. So please, there was another one here at the front. Thank you.
Okay. First, to introduce myself, I'm Kelmund. I'm representing a network that is connecting local governments from 12 countries in Southeast Europe. And I'm referring to Madam Vice Minister, the highlight of her speech was related to a very important topic on categorization of information. It could be an obstacle, especially for transnational knowledge sharing. And our experience, because we are doing in our network a monitoring of fiscal decentralization once a year, and we, from the day one, we faced with this problem. What in one country, what they mean by, for instance, communal tax is not the same in the other country, and in the expenditure side, for instance, of the budget of local governments, what is in the category of investments for public services? In some countries, they do not account also the investments of public utility companies, only the municipal budget, for instance. But our experience is that the discussion about these differences in categorizing in itself is a knowledge exchange. And it's a very interesting discussion for this, because there are reasons why in some countries this is not done in a way. And in itself, this discussion is very important. And our cure to this was that we still do the benchmarking, and it's a very successful product. But we acknowledge in the document what are the differences in the definitions. And this is the way how we make it transparent, but still the comparison is very important because it creates a peer pressure. No country wants to see themselves in the end of the list.
Thank you very much. I'm going to take the last person who's standing up already, and then we'll come back to the panel for some answers, please.
Hi, my name is Gabrielle, and I work in the health sector here at the World Bank. And my question is, we've been discussing a little bit of verticals shared or knowledge sharing. So in the population, and the government collects that data, and then they share with their respective sectors in other countries. But I'd like to talk a little bit or hear your experiences for horizontal sharing. So within different sectors, do you guys transnationally there talk about health and education together? What can you learn from your education sectors? What can you learn from social development is maybe a little more evident and multi-sectoral, but how do you share knowledge and gain knowledge between the sectors, and how has that benefited your work?
Thank you very much. Some very good questions. And just in case you thought you were off the hook, Minister, Vice Minister Rubio, perhaps do you still talk to your international finance colleagues? And do you share lessons between that and social development? But please, any of our panelists, three very good questions there. Would you like to start? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Well, I very interesting, the questions, Hashanti, Kelmant, and Gabriel. I hope I pronounce well, everyone. I think for starting with Gabrielle, yes, in the social ministry, social development ministry, we share a lot of information with the rest of the ministries, but we are now starting the first national database for social programs in Mexico. It's something that we thought there was something that should be available always. Well, that's not available. That doesn't exist yet. That doesn't exist in many countries of the world. So we first created the database from the social ministry. Now we're creating the national database with all those social programs that are being made by other ministries, by other institutions, also by state authorities and also by municipal authorities. So in a year from now, I think we will have one of the most robust databases of social programs in the country. And with that, we can do a lot of things, especially focusing more, focusing better, and trying to design better policies. On what Mr. Kelman said, I think it's very important that we disclose and make transparent all the concepts, the indexes, the methodologies, because with that, we are able to see if we're comparing pairs with pairs, as I said before. I used to work in 1994. My first job was to be part of the team that made the Mexico's access to the OECD. And I remember a lot of the work the OECD was carrying out, trying to do standards and benchmarks, because concepts as simple as unemployment were measured completely different around the world. So what they did was what you said. They made the comparison, and then you had like all the footnotes saying, well, in this country it's measured this way, in this other country. So then that makes you question the comparability at all, no, of the whole thing. So I think the more transparent the concepts and the measurements and the methodologies are, the better we are going to be able to create these indexes and these best practices in order to be able to make them comparable. And just very quick, I think we need to develop more on the tacit knowledge being transferable. I think it's done on a practical way, but not with a methodology and with a concept and with the objective of that having a specific value, and the way that value can serve us all to better, in my case, better policy making and better policy evaluation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Either our other two panelists.
So coming to the first question, in healthcare or in medicine, it is pretty clear, because we have new paradigm, and it's called evidence-based medicine or evidence-based decision-making. So you combine three elements, actually. Always you combine three elements. So you combine evidence with experience and with values. And definitely evidence is there in many cases, and evidence is transferable. Experience could be, though, different, and values could be different in different countries. But approaches for implementation of these two factors to decision-making, these are, I'd say, common and well-shared among the most developed countries. So if you think about developing countries, those procedures, standard procedures, those, let's say, those methods are there, and they require only proper implementation. And now we come to another question, because, you know, in many places, these people who govern nations or institutions, they don't want to learn. They don't want to change their operational procedures. They want to stick to what they were learned. So I'm saying that, you know, overtaking my department, because in at Ministry of Health, I'm responsible for let's say, heavy armory. This is content of basic benefit package, drug policy, and prices. And, you know, I'm saying that I need to change people, or people need to be changed. That's it. You have, let me repeat, you have three factors of success: people, people, and people. And some people are silo breakers, and they do look for, like dendrites, right? They look for another links to other cells, and some don't. They are closed. They don't want to listen to anybody. They know the best, and they are not looking for any new knowledge or new connections, or don't want to share also what they think. They don't want to be criticized. So such people, they just don't belong to modern institutions. In Poland, we have currently very open horizontal thinking. One of our prime ministers, vice prime minister, he's silo breaker. He said no more silo Poland, or so ministries need to communicate, they need to learn from one another. And what we actually, how we implement that policy, is that we create teams, or you may call it think tanks. So there is a problem, like, for example, currently we are working on national drug policy, and there are 10 ministries and main governmental institutions representatives working together. So these think tanks, they produce certain conclusions which are implemented. But you need to have a leader who's actually willing to break the silos, who actually is willing to gain knowledge, the leader who's not saying, I know the best, I'm Alpha and Omega. No, the one who knows, I don't know many things, I want to learn, I'm open to knowledge, and you should have the same attitude. And you also, let's say, infect your employees with that attitude. This is what should be going on. So positive infections, I'd say.
Thank you. Can I challenge you, Minister Fabiano, to pick up this issue? Because I think it's really interesting. How do you challenge ways of thinking, ways of doing things, if they're no longer correct? So if you're dealing with teachers and ways of learning in Malawi, is this something you come across? And how do you, as the minister, try and bring about this cultural change? Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I'll respond to the initial question and extend to what you have just said. I would like to start off from what my colleague has stopped mentioning, and to emphasize the point that many people that are well educated with a lot of experience assume that anybody else who is less educated and does not have the same level of experience, they don't know as much, and there's nothing to learn from them. I think that is where the problem starts. And therefore, I do agree that it should start with us who claim to know better. And I'll give you two examples. The first is for Malawi, where for many years, research was done to promote fish populations in Lake Malawi. The results were dismal. The researchers had to go and hold series of discussions with people, what we call fish villages, people who live along the lake, to begin to understand what happens, to begin to agree how they can manage the fish populations so that the numbers go up. And within 3-4 years, the populations went up. They had to work with the communities that live around the lake. The second one is in health. My background is chemistry. I've done natural products chemistry. I've done research in traditional medicine, etc. I have colleagues for many years that never believed that traditional medicine was of any use, because they were trained in America and Britain and elsewhere. They didn't think the people in the villages know anything. And yet, 85% of the population lives in the villages. Their first call in terms of medicine is traditional medicine. That has changed. The College of Medicine in Malawi, which is one of the best in the region, offers traditional medicine as part of its program. This is what we need to do. We must accept and understand that a lot of tacit knowledge is very important and useful, but if we ignore it, we are not going to get it, and it's not going to be used. Similarly, with teachers in the schools. Teachers in the schools teach as per guidelines, but there are some excellent people that do much more than what you ask them to do. In other words, there's a lot we can learn from our teachers if only we have the patience to go and observe objectively and capture the lessons that we can learn from them, as opposed to saying, because I trained you to become a teacher, I know better than you do. So we need to capture those examples of good practice that should be shared with other teachers in order to infect other people to do a better job. Now, coming to the vertical versus the horizontal knowledge sharing, yes, it's easier to share knowledge vertically, where the people at the lower levels report to their bosses, the people at the bottom, at the top, sharing information to those below. And that's also partly why the tacit knowledge is not coming out as much as it should. In Malawi, I'll give you again two examples. And the two examples relate to the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology. When we talk about education, we are talking about all aspects of education from kindergarten up to PhD. However, what we have done is to say for the kindergarten, it will be in a different ministry where they deal with gender, children, disability, and social welfare. But we also realize that issues to do with gender are very important at primary school level and secondary school level, as well as tertiary education. We need to promote girls' education, so gender issues do come in. And similarly, children that have gone to nursery schools tend to do better in primary schools than those that have not gone to nursery schools. And therefore, we have no choice but to work with that ministry because there is a lot of overlap and the, we need each other. Technical education technical and vocational education is in a different ministry where they do, technical and vocational education, youth and other things. We work with them. And fortunately, to our advantage, the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology is the policy holder for all aspects of education in Malawi. And therefore, we do work with other ministries. Similarly, Ministry of Health. Within the Ministry of Health, they are responsible for all aspects of nutrition, because nutrition is important as it impacts on health. HIV and AIDS is under Ministry of Health. And again, because we need to have children in the schools that are adequately nourished, the school feeding program is implemented by the Ministry of Education, much as the policy, at policy level, nutrition is under Ministry of Health. And similarly, HIV and AIDS is implemented with the support of the Ministry of Education, because the people that we need to worry about and care about more are those youth that are in schools. And therefore, Ministry of Health cannot implement those HIV and AIDS issues to the general public and ignore the schools. And these are two examples that I can give that we do have a good amount of vertical knowledge sharing to make sure that we impact on each other and we maximize the resources that we have and add value to what each other or all the other ministries are doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm just checking my managers. We're okay? We should finish. Okay, so we're just beginning to get some really interesting practical examples, I think, of what people are doing. And this message of people, I think, is a really important one about how do we get the right people with the right skills, motivate them, get the right culture, is clearly very important. And also silo breakers is something I think I'll take away, as well as thinking about data and openness and participation, all very, very important. But I also really like this idea of identifying and showcasing places where it's really working, where people are achieving huge results going above and beyond, but also where it's not working. And I think that's a really important one for development partners to take away, that we don't always get it right, particularly when we aren't listening and looking at the local context. And I think collecting and capturing some of those lessons of where it hasn't worked is as important as sharing lessons of where it has. So thank you very much to all three of you for very interesting interventions, and we will continue the discussion. Thank you. Thank you.